How's everybody doing? You guys hear me okay? Good. You guys saw that safety video, yeah? Good. That pretty much covers everything. Also, just so you guys do know, though, I do have some communication to do during the flight, so if you guys hear me, just like pause in mid-sentence right in the middle of telling you something, don't worry. Nothing's wrong. I'm just communicating. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. They want our full attention with air traffic control around the airspace here near the runways because of all the jets coming in and out too. So I'll be just with ATC for the first and last 5 minutes of the flight. And that's it. Everybody doing so far? Good. Well, we got nice weather for a flight up to Haleakala. You can see the summit poking above the clouds there. That's where we're headed first. So we are going to be flying kind of high like an airplane here for a little bit until we get up to the crater. Once we get a good view of the Haleakala crater, then we'll go via helicopters. We'll get you right over the rainforest and hover up next to waterfalls. No waterfalls below us anyways. You can see it's kind of like a desert down here. And that's because of the wind direction. It's real consistent. The wind is almost always from the northeast. So it'll push rain showers onto the northeast side of this island. Not much will make it over to this side, so it's real dry. So if you look off our right side, you can see Kihei and Wailea. There's lots of resorts and hotels. But in the past, you wouldn't ever live out there. You'd be over on the other side. Before the 1800s, the Hawaiian population was mostly in the small towns of Kipahulu and Hana that you'll see a little bit later on in the flight. We do get this halo of clouds that we're going to hop over here to get up to the crater. We get this from the daytime heating. Right now the sun's real intense. It's heating up the surface of the ocean when the water evaporates, follows the contour of the mountain, turns to clouds. So you'll see it get a little greener up at the higher elevations of Haleakala for that reason. Up there at the summit of Haleakala. If you look real closely, you'll see some telescopes and observatories. Those are mostly operated by the Air Force, like most of it's looking out instead of looking up. And then there's a ridgeline to the right of those observatories. It's called the Southwest Rift Zone. And it's a ridgeline created by a chain of eruptions. The volcanoes in Hawaii, they don't just erupt on the summit. They erupt all up and down the sides of them. The last eruption, in fact, for Haleakala was way at the very end of the Southwest Rift Zone, and that was just above sea level. And that was around 1790-ish, they say. They don't know the exact date because it was before written down recorded history, and that's why Haleakala is technically a dormant volcano. They say it's practically active, though. They do expect another eruption someday, so we're all looking forward to that. Maybe on this flight, or no. But for now, you really got to go to the Big Island of Hawaii and see the erupting volcano. Now, when the volcanoes do erupt in Hawaii, they don't necessarily explode. You have like slower, longer eruptions. Current eruption on the Big Island, longest eruption of the recorded history, 36 years and counting. Big forest up here, and it was all planted. The reason why is because Hawaii imports, as you can imagine, like an incredible amount of lumber to build everything. So it's like building up a natural resource. They planted California redwood trees, different cedars, all kinds of different trees, so that someday we'll be so reliant on importing lumber. Now the California redwood is already over 100 feet tall here at the Port Hoy State Park. You can go hike around them. It doesn't really get enough rain to get like waterfalls or rivers or anything, but still some nice hiking trails. You can hike through these pine forests. If you have a four-wheel drive, you can take that dirt road down there. Eventually it goes all the way up to the southwest Frisco, and you can like hike around some of the old Frisco. Most days you get a pretty good view of the big island from the southwest Frisco. You cannot make it all the way up to the summit of Haleakala from the state park, but you can still get good views from up here at about 7,000 feet. The Big Island of Hawaii coming into view out in the distance. You got Mauna Kea, Mauna Loa, the tops of them just barely in that high layer of clouds. Almost 14,000 feet tall, those volcanoes. Largest volcanoes on the planet. And as you look down, you can see the old eruption sites here. The red color that you'll see is high iron levels. The iron will rust over time, turn red like that. You'll see that red color in some of these cinder cones. Up there at the summit, that little cinder cone just to the right of those observatories is the true summit, the tallest point of volcano, little small structure on there, and you can like pretty much drive right at that point, 10,023 feet tall. Then there's a hiking trail that'll take you down into the largest crater in all of Hawaii. Even though the Big Island of Hawaii has got bigger volcanoes, Haleakala has got the biggest crater. And according to geologists, it's because of glaciers. They say glaciers formed within the one smaller crater and made it deeper and wider. We get up another couple hundred feet, we'll be able to look over this ridgeline and into the largest crater in all of Hawaii. Thank you. going to leave the Haleakala crater in just a second. We'll work our way down to the rainforest. As we descend, we're going to feel a little pressure in our ears. Just try to yawn or chew gum if you have it. Kind of releases some of that pressure. So just like driving down, someone called up. Just keep driving down a little faster, though. Try to clear your ears before they start bothering you. And we'll be up next to some waterfalls here in a second.
Working against me, and gravity wants to bring me down. Oh, I'll never know what makes us mad with all the love that his heart can stand. Dream of ways to throw it all away. Whoa, gravity is working against me, and gravity wants to bring me down. Oh, twice as much, ain't twice as good, and can't sustain like one half could. It's one and more, it's gonna send me to my knees.
elevations and remote locations. This is where you'll see some of the most pristine native forests in all of Hawaii. These are koa trees. All these trees along these canyon walls are koa trees. You'll see Hawaiian ferns, the ones with the bigger leaves that grow 20 feet tall, like trees. Maybe not so much in this particular valley because of the wind, but they can grow for over 1,000 years, some of the taller ferns. And Ohia Lehu trees. As far as the wildlife goes, if you look closely, you might see mountain goats and deer. So native trees, but not native animals. Those animals have been introduced over here. Few houses down there off our right, but that was once the biggest city on the island. Captain Cook referred to that area as rooftops in his journals when he discovered Hawaii, because it's all rooftops, a massive Hawaiian city. Disease and virus wiped out these big cities, though, in the 1800s. The trade ships that came after Captain Cook introduced malaria and influenza and leprosy and the rats, mice, and mosquitoes that spread disease. Hawaiian population went from somewhere around 300,000 to 40,000 in a 100-year span. Like cities like Kipahulu here disappeared. No more tall trees or thick forests. Everything's real short. It's because of the age of the land. If you look at the riverbed, it's all lava rock. There's just a few inches of topsoil on this part of the island. A relatively young land. Within the last few thousand years, these are all lava flows coming down out from the east rift zone. just flew up and over the southwest drift zone to see the crater. Now we're over the east drift zone. The spinner cone's all covered in greenery because of the daily rain showers we get over here. And the town of Hana sits there at our 12 o'clock at the very end of the east drift zone. Hana's real famous mostly because the road to Hana is through the rainforest. A lot of people drive right through the town. Never even missed it. Small community out there. The Hana cones, they glow in this light green color because they're covered in wild ginger, tea leaves, and even species of shorter bamboo up here. And they look pretty cool, so we'll fly through some of the undercones on the way out to our next waterfall. Eucalyptus trees, kind of a bizarre row of trees, how it turns, but it's to mark out a property line. Before GPS and all that, they planted these eucalyptus trees from Australia because they grow faster and taller than all the native trees. They mark out property lines, but also canal systems and pipelines that get covered in the fast-growing rainforest. Well, that's just see the Hana Highway winding through these canyons. This is like an hour and a half into the road to Hana. You can see pools of water and waterfalls that you can hike to. They're real adventurous. You can hike upstream, and there's like ropes and rope ladders literally in some of the waterfalls. It's real dangerous. People get hurt all the time. Technically illegal, so if any of that bothers you, don't get it. But we'll do some turns over this highway. You can look down below and see a little bit of the Hana Highway and some of these pools of water, waterfalls out there. Hundreds of inches of annual rainfall just a couple thousand feet above this location, so these aquifers always full and pushing water out onto the surface. Next we'll see some more unique waterfalls in the back of the Honolulu Valley. Into the mid-1900s took like over 60 years to build this canal. People lived and died up here in the rainforest, digging this ditch for the sugar cane to divert these streams and rivers into central Maui to water the sugar cane. They don't harvest the sugar cane anymore, so they don't care if it gets watered. And that's why the gates are open and the water goes all the way down to the bottom of the valley now and eventually out to the ocean. I do want to thank you guys for coming out flying with me. I don't get to go flying without you guys. They don't let me out by myself, so thanks for getting in here so we can all get up in the air. And then once we do land, just sit tight, wait for Kat or Chris. They'll help you out of the aircraft. They'll set you up and stop you. If you want the video of the flight, we recorded all that. It's got you guys on there, your flight music and everything. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. Thanks a lot for flying with me.